Today, we will try to put an audio on this video strip from movies dating all the way back to 1936 and crewing after my father got his 16mm Kodak camera with cassettes, and he was a very veteran photographer and tried many things. Basically, these films, which began in 1936 and ran through to about 1950, are the tales of two families. One is the Mueller family, who was my mother's family. That's Florence Barbara Mueller. That was her maiden name. And she came from Dayton, and her family and the patriarch, Carl F. Mueller, who was an immigrant from Germany, having come here to this country in about 1885 at the age of 25. He set up a family business in Dayton, in the grocery business. It was a white villa grocer, so it was an independent grocer. And had his store on Salem Avenue in Dayton. And business lasted a good number of years. He and his wife, who was a Shantz, which was a prominent Dayton family, who were second generation immigrants, were married. And her maiden name was Barbara Shantz. They had four children, the oldest of which was Helen, a daughter, followed by Carl, the firstborn son, who I believe was 2 or 3 years younger, and then my mother, Florence, was third in succession, followed by the youngest child, Mary. As of today, which is July 2005, all the children passed away. Carl, the patriarch, lived until age 94, and he was a very vibrant, vigorous type of individual who was always optimistic about life and felt that technology could solve any problem. But he was a true optimist, high energy type person, and just a delightful individual. Very characteristic of what I would classify as an archer, typical German. His wife was more subdued, but a very fine mother, and I only knew her in her later years, in which time she was afflicted with cataracts and diabetes, but still was felt to be a wonderful mother in every sense. The family home in Dayton, Ohio, right opposite the Ridge Planetarium on Ridge Avenue, and the Wendel family from Cincinnati went to Dayton pretty much on all the major holidays, as did all the other children with their families, and it was a grand time. As we go along here, I'll tell you some of the characters. This is Grandpa Wendel, the other side of the family, who was widowed, or widowered, when his wife died at an early age, about 55, due to pneumonia. This house that's being shown here is where we lived on Elizabeth Place from 1936 until 1943. This is the family, my mother Florence here on the left, brother Art on the right. In this particular scene, we're going out on a Christmas tree, which was often bought live at that time and planted in the yard. But we lived in Bond Hill for 7 years, and I was born in 1936, and this is me as a 1 or 2 year old child, Richard George Wendel. My brother, his name was Arthur William Wendel Jr. He was some 6 years my senior, and he was born in 1929. My sister was still older, at 7 years older than I, and was born in 1938. This is a fireplace in the addition that we put on in Bond Hill. My father was very proud of this. It had a actual gas-burning fireplace, and here are the three of us kids in front of it. There's my mother who's come into the picture. My father has set the camera so he could come in the picture as well. And this is the entire family constellation, which was pretty much a typical German family, providing for themselves and being quite sufficient and independent. We should go back and digress a bit as to the Wendel family. The Wendel clan came over from Germany, the Alsace-Lorraine area of Germany in the early 1830s. One great-great-great-grandfather fought in the Civil War, and we actually have his Civil War rifle. They too were in the grocery business, and for a number of generations had a grocery store down on McMicken Avenue near Main Street, or excuse me, Walnut Street. There were, in the Wendel family, three boys. The oldest was George F. Wendel III, who was my uncle. My father was younger by several years and was born in the year 1900. And then there was a younger brother, I just blocked on his name for some reason, Albert Wendel. And all the boys did well. Uncle George was in the grocery business and was his chief executive at White Villa Grocers and established the plant up in Dayton, and had one child, Marjorie, who also had quite a prominent life, and that she married John Barry Jr., the heir to the L&M Berry Company, and lived very well. She had four sons, the oldest being George, who went to Dartmouth, as did his father, John Barry. Then there was another John Barry Jr., who is still there running the business in Dayton. And then Charlie, who's another distant relative, second cousin, who still works in the Berry business. Then Albert Wendel had two children, Bob Wendel, who was born in 1933, and Carolyn Wendel, who was born the same year I was, in 1936. Bob was an architect and still practicing here in Cincinnati, and his sister, Carolyn, has been married, has several daughters, and now lives in Florida. These pictures that we're seeing now are of a Christmas when money was no longer tight. When my father and mother got married in 1925, that's Florence and Art, they had between them $1,900, which she mainly brought to the relationship, having worked for a while in a bank as a younger woman. The early years were difficult for them, with my father just new in practice and having to eke out a living through working in the receiving physician at the Cincinnati General Hospital, and also running the health service there at the University of Cincinnati. This is me as a child, opening presents, which were pretty plentiful in those times, but not so plentiful as we see today. This is my older brother, Art. Being a policeman was fashionable in those days, and a revered occupation. I never forget those pajamas with the feet in them that you tripped over. My father kind of alternated between black and white and Kodachrome movies. I'm not sure why. When you think of these pictures as now being over 70 years old, why, it's pretty remarkable the preservation. Over the years, we've had the 16mm motion picture film transferred to VHS, and I think that's been partially responsible for the good preservation of color. This was my tricycle as a kid, which I was dearly fond of, and which was my freedom vehicle, so to speak. Toys were rather uncomplicated in those days, since there were no battery-operated toys. Additionally, we didn't have TV in those days, and just radio, and there were just a few channels. This is Ruth Allen, my older sister. Before moving to Bond Hill in 1936, they lived over by the university in an apartment on Howell Avenue. It was convenient for my father to live there close to the hospitals. My father was a urologist and practiced urologic surgery for about 40 years prior to his retirement in 1969. That was 2 years after I joined his practice as a practicing urologist. My dad's office was down in the Crewe Tower for about 35 years, as was mine in subsequent years. We weren't too good with skis, but they were purchased anyway, and the bindings were a lot different than they are today. This is at the Crone Conservatory, which my father dearly loved and took many pictures of. Here are the three of us going down the snow-colored, covered driveway there on Elizabeth Place. It was a nice home, but very modest, and when I go to buy the sixth hole that it borders at Macatewell Country Club, I'm always impressed how small a home it really was. And there's a good picture of all three of us. These are some trips that we took, and this particular trip we took with Uncle George and his wife, Charlotte. This was the Banff, Lake Louise, Canadian Rockies, and also down through Washington and Oregon. It was an interesting trip, and Uncle George had some business contacts out there, and we went through the Dole Pineapple factory and had a limousine and the whole bit. Really quite a wonderful trip. As were several others that we took to the western United States. That's Charlotte and George on the left there. George was always somewhat on the heavy side. Here we're playing golf at the Jasper National Park golf course. At the time I was about 12, so I would put this in the late 40s. My brother Art was an avid golfer, and when he went to Babson, he played golf on the golf team there. He got his business degree from Babson College in Boston after spending a year at UC undergraduate in liberal arts. in my brother and father. In those days, they used to feed the bears in the dumps, which was dangerous to say the least, and certainly a practice that is outlawed today, but in those days it was quite permissible. And of course, the bears later became a problem, and many had to be exterminated. Here we are in a canoe. In those days, there weren't many motorboats, and paddling a canoe or rowing a boat was pretty common entertainment. This is Lake Louise, and here we visit a glacier, many of which are now receding due to global warming. Here the whole clan went for a horseback ride up to the base of that distant mountain. There's George Wendel and my mother Florence, and this is some special photography with reflections in the crystal globe. My father also took his still camera with him, and we have literally thousands of pictures, and I'm not at all certain what I should do with those. Riding a chairlift was a big deal in those days. Some people skied in those days, but it was a very small percentage of the population compared to today, when there are many, many more ski resorts and much, much better ski equipment. Interestingly, when I went to Dartmouth College between 1954 and 1957, I bought skis and went skiing there, but sold them before I came back to Ohio and home because I never thought I'd ski again. And yet today, most all of my friends have or continue to ski from time to time. Here's the whole crew. My mother and father, Florence and Art. In those days, they would have been probably in their mid-40s. And both George and Art were very enamored with cigar smoking. In many of these pictures, you'll see them with a cigar in their mouth. They really didn't smoke cigarettes, although my sister Ruth smoked heavily and paid a price in health care, in her health status later on. This is in Bonneville Dam, where the salmon are jumping up the runs. in Washington State. Then here's just one of those waterfalls along the Columbia River basin. This is another tour that we took. And my father was a member of the Pan American Doctors Club, and they had a hacienda down there near Mexico City in the late 40s and early 50s, and this is some bullfighting in Mexico. I've included this footage because of the brutality, and I have never seen a bullfight, and they, of course, have outlawed it in many countries. It's rather brutal, and I have a hard time understanding how people can get into this as a sport. Here's a new fresh bull. Here we are at another trip that we took. This one, a Grand Western Circuit out to the western states, and it encompassed Yellowstone National Park, Bryan, Zion, and the Grand Canyon. This is, of course, Yellowstone Falls. It's a good picture of Ruthie there. There I come into the camera in the picture. There's a good picture of my sister Ruth in her younger days when she would have been a teenager. This here is a custom that was present in those early days where all the waitresses would bid the tourists farewell, and one of their rituals was having the young men go through a line and be kissed by all the waitresses. Needless to say, it was not the most sanitary practice. And I'm sure today would not be condoned. This is Bryce Canyon, which was one of my favorite spots. These are pictures in Mexico when my father and mother went to the Pan American Doctors Club Hacienda on a time or two. There's my father's physique. Not a very athletic man, and the extent of his athletic endeavors really was stickball when he was a kid in the alley. My mother, on the other hand, was quite athletic and a fairly good tennis player and could beat my father. My father and mother took up golf later in life, and I never developed a great deal of skill at it. These are some pictures during the late 40s when President Truman went to Mexico to renew relations after the Second World War, and this was a great celebration and I thought worthy of inclusion of some pictures of the ceremony, since it was so extensive for the time and reflected the culture of Mexico and the Aztecs, not to mention the Mayans. There's a maypole dance. Now, during the Second World War, there was rationing, and we used to grow chickens so that we had some food. We raised baby chicks on a ping pong table in our basement. Then we also had a victory garden, and we saved up the stamps so that on Christmas we all could have a big T-bone steak. My father, by virtue of being a doctor, had an A sticker, so he got additional gallons of gas allotment so we could take some vacations during the summer. These are the chickens we raised. After these baby chicks grew up, why, we would pluck them and barber and cut them up, and that would be a big meal. Here we are in front of our house on Victoria Boulevard, where we moved from Bond Hill, and this was in Hyde Park, a very lovely colonial house designed by Charlie Solarius, who was a very prominent Cincinnati architect. That's George Carl Mueller on the right, grandfather Mueller. And there's Grandpa and Grandma Mueller together, one of the best pictures that I have. During our early years, when we were 8 to 10, both my brother, sister, and I were sent to camp. My sister to Camp Fourway, and my brother and I to Camp Fairwood. There's my brother settling in there in Camp Fairwood in the typical cabin. Many Cincinnatis went to Fairwood, which was on Torch Lake in Michigan. This was the Indian dancing was a big thing at Fairwood, and Bernard Mason was the one that brought this Indian culture there, and was actually world famous and wrote several books on Indian folklore. My sister Ruth. We used to swim there at Camp Fairwood, and also where we vacationed in Houghton Lake. And I must say, the water in Michigan was very, very cold, and it was never a very pleasant experience. Of course, we wore life preservers. Were rather bulky and not very, and pretty cumbersome by today's standards. These films are not in exact chronological order, and here we're back in the late 30s. From time to time, we went to Florida. Usually to Fort Lauderdale. Beach activity was big. We had these windbreaker type shelters and cabanas. I remember once being stung by a Portuguese man of war. Pretty nasty sting. This is my father Arthur and sister Ruth. And you can note the rather ancient design of the swimsuits at the time. Bikinis were really risque and not at all something that was accepted. My sister standing on her head. Later on, she went through Miami University and became an architect. All of us kids went to Withrow High School. My brother being in the class of 1949, my sister 1947, and I was in the class of 1954. Here's a birthday party for my brother. It's of interest that Tony Trabert was one of the guests there at the birthday party, right here on the right-hand side of the picture. This was on Elizabeth Place, would have been about 1948. That's Tony Trabert, the tennis star. He won Wimbledon again several times. Also as a commentator. Over at the Macatawa Country Club, where we were members, they used to freeze the terrace in the back and we'd go ice skating. I don't think we did that very well, but we had a good time. I guess we were members of Macatawa for 7 or 8 years, and then Hyde Park for quite a few years. We all took up golf. This is another trip of my father and mother to Florida. And this would have been 1943, and that's Grandma Mueller and Grandpa Mueller. There I am, probably... I guess maybe 5 years old, 6, 7 maybe. Here's the group alongside the old Buick. We're a family of Buick, 236, 38, and this was a 1939 Buick. These are friends of my sister, and I think one is Phyllis Middleman. Here I am doing a magic trip during our trip to Florida. Here I am at Camp Fairwood. Remember, my stay there wasn't real pleasant. Didn't like it much. Well, we're coming to the end of this segment, and this will be one chapter of many that I plan to convert onto DVD for prolonged storage. So there'll be more to come. This is at Houghton Lake. This is the fourth segment with one more to go before I finish up on the Wendel family movies from the early 1930s. As an introduction, I've done some titles on nice shots with just some overlay to give a brief sketch of the people that you're observing. Uncle Al and Aunt Sue was my father's brother. George Wendel was very influential in the Wendel family, and being a mentor, and also even loaned money to Art to get through medical school, and insisted that Art go to medical school. This is Aunt Mary and Uncle Pat at their wedding. She got married somewhat late in life and had one child, Carolyn. Carolyn Patterson, and who turned out really to be wonderful daughter and family gal. This is our family. That's Aunt Mary, all decked up for her wedding. She's really a very close friend of my mother, Florence, and spent a lot of time here in Cincinnati, as we did in Dayton, Ohio. This is musical chairs at a birthday party for my sister in our backyard. In those days, we used to go to church virtually every Sunday down at Salem Evangelical and Reformed Church on Sycamore and Orchard Street. This particular church had as one of its original founding members back in the 1830s our great-great-great-grandfather. The sanctuary is still very pretty even today, and they're doing some upgrading of it. The family always had a fascination with trains, and these were two trains that were purchased this particular Christmas, and my father used some of his special photographic techniques to capture it. Okay, as we continue here, my family had somewhat of a romance with trains when I was a kid. And so there's a lot of pictures of trains and such. This is my brother acting as an engineer. This is a new train with two different engines, one a work engine and the other a Pullman engine, or passenger car engine. And it was quite a plaything for a while on a big sheet of plywood on our playroom. Occasionally they would stage a derailment for the benefit of the photographer. It's interesting how little Lionel trains have changed since those very early days to today. In fact, the transformers are almost identical. This is a trip to Lookout Mountain that my mother and father took. He also usually went to Florida each winter, and as a part of the trip, often went to Cypress Gardens to see the water skiing pageant. And this, of course, is just the last year or two and closed completely. No longer do you have those Southern Belle's beauties that decorate a very lovely botanical garden. Bicycles built for two were pretty common in those days, as they are today. Bicycles, though, only had one gear in those days, with their very fat tires.
unlike today's bicycles that have any number of speeds all the way up to 20 or so, and skinny tires. The handlebars also were in a more comfortable position in those days than today. At least it seems that way to me. The swimwear in those days was not the two-piece bikini by any means. They covered a fair amount of their body, although the men didn't wear shirts like they did in earlier times. Going to the beach and spending the whole day was very common. When you went to the beach, you didn't wear sunscreen in those days, and consequently sunburn was much more of a problem than ever it is today. Often you'd go to Hialeah or Gulfstream, which were the two race tracks down in Florida, as a part of your side activities. My father and mother were not particularly gamblers at all. In fact, they were against bingo. Even at the churches, said never gamble. Scene of our backyard. This is my playset, which is comparable to those of today, but not nearly as elaborate, nor with the variety of different things. The teeter-totter was still in those days. I haven't seen a teeter-totter around at a playground for a long time. Perhaps it's a liability issue. This was my mother's rock garden, which she tended faithfully, and it was beautiful, but didn't have nearly the variety of different flowers that we have today. There are the three of us getting ready to go to church at Salem Church. Our grandfather was one of the great-great-great-grandfather was one of the founding members. We all three were confirmed there. It's an Easter egg hunt. And now we've shifted gears and we're now into the 50s. And this is a different time. I don't know why such a big gap. This is my mother and our dog Wendy, and we live in Indian Hill at this particular time. And my father had a fascination with Cadillac cars, and used to get a new Cadillac every 2 years. This was our home in Indian Hill that we moved to in about 1952. We built this on 3.5 acres in Albar Acres there in Indian Hill, and had a view of the city in a magnificent place. And this is a prefab home, the ranch style, which is of course not too popular today. And for the most part in Indian Hill, these old ranch-style houses are just teardowns. My sister and then this is Matt as a child, the second-born grandson. This is Ann and I when we were courting, and we did that a long time. We met in high school when I was a senior and she was a junior. And we met on a blind date to a formal, and then our courting spanned about 6 or 7 years until we got married in 1959. The furnishings in the house there in Indian Hill were very contemporary because Ruth and Don were very much into that type of furniture, as you'll see in some of these subsequent pictures. They influenced Mom Florence's taste in furniture. You can see the drapery as being very geometric in its style. As I said, we often went to Florida for trips, and this is just another one of those. In those days, I usually went to a place like Fort Lauderdale or Hollywood Beach on the east coast of Florida, whereas now Cincinnatians primarily go to the west coast, Naples, and that area. These are some good friends of my mom and dad, Mildred and Joe Zugelder. Joe was a CPA. This is, on the left is my cousin Carolyn playing the ukulele, which was an instrument that was not uncommon in those days, but which you never see anymore. This is Al and Bobby's son. Bobby's a very successful architect, and I must say, not a bad golfer, since we go out and play golf from time to time, even this at this late date in 2005. The Wendel clan had a sort of a cultural thing of always giving one another a kiss when they were on camera, I guess, in those days of the silent movies. Why, you need to show some activity, so it seemed like everybody kissed on the film. I guess that a picture's worth a thousand words, perhaps. This is Don and Ruth, I think before they were married, still courting. Don had... our home in Hyde Park on Victoria Boulevard. We lived at 43130 Victoria, which is a magnificent colonial home designed by Charlie Solarius and Fosdick, and it still stands today as a magnificent place with a wonderful front yard and some beautiful beech trees and all the modern things in the interior of the house, including cork insulation, a central vacuuming system, and a lot of things that today are quite common. And it was ahead of its times. This is a wedding party, and most of the bridesmaids were relatives, for the most part, from Dayton, Ohio. This is a Withrow High School marching band on the Withrow Field. All three of us went to Withrow High School. I graduated in 1954, and I believe Art in 1948, and Ruth in 1947. Withrow in the 60s and 70s kind of deteriorated a bit, but there's been a revival of Withrow and a restructuring of it, and indeed the Cincinnati Public School System has done some wonderful things there, and I'm very actively involved in the Alumni Association. There's Ann and I, before we were married. Also in the Wendel tradition, trying to kiss. Opening Christmas presents. At Christmas time, often Ray Storch, who was a neighbor there in Indian Hill, would visit to give presents to the grandchildren. It was quite an occasion. He's a fine gentleman. Our audio-visual equipment in those days, in the 50s, was a bit primitive by today's standards. We had 33 RPM records and 45 RPM records. And the TV sets were small, and there were only maybe three or four channels with programming that went off the air at night, basically. Motorola recorder, and I still have some of those tapes, and we'll incorporate some of them in our audiovisual material. These are my father's two partners in urology, Ed Hoffman to his right and Will Ratledge to his left. They were great friends, and Eddie Hoffman, only practiced with him a handful of years prior to an untimely demise due to gastric cancer. You can see some of the modernistic furniture we had in those days when we were in Indian Hill. Before that time, in the home in Hyde Park, we had pretty much conventional, traditional-type furniture. I showed that one picture of myself throwing a baseball, since now I have a terrible rotator cuff problem, and even though I coach a little league team in conjunction with my son, who is the head coach, I cannot throw a baseball overhanded any longer. It's also impacted my tennis. The farm out in Claremont County between Owensville and Williams Corner was a very real place to gather during the 50s. My father bought all of 388 acres there in the early 50s, and this was a place where we all congregated. This is where we had the Dayton crew down. There's a picture of the home, and in the back there was a swimming pool, and further on back a wooded area where they had a wonderful creek that you could walk on and truly feel you were away in nature. Of an interesting figure, Clement Rowe. He was somewhat of an eccentric, but I found him a very interesting man. There's a good picture of Uncle George and Uncle Al. This is Ruth and Don with their first baby, Mark, their first grandchild. There's Bobby Wendel, first cousin. And the three boys together. They were very supportive of one another, very close, and remained so throughout their lives. It was a wonderful triad, even though none of them got along particularly well with their own father. That dog Wendy was really a neighborhood pet. He would spend nights throughout the neighborhood there in Indian Hill. These are pictures of my brother when he graduated from Babson College in Boston with a medical degree, with a business degree. After that, he went to work for National Cash Register for a while, and then into the building and loan business, and was with 7th Ward Building and Loan down and on Walnut and Liberty for many, many years as CEO. think we're coming to an end here. This is the third or fourth in the series of films of the Wendel clan, starting in about 1936. I've started this with some titles that show good pictures of the family in general. My mother, father, and the three of us kids. And these were indeed very happy days during the 30s and 40s. We lived on Elizabeth Place, 1534 Elizabeth Place, which was right opposite the Bond Hill School, which has is now scheduled to be torn down and closed there in Bond Hill. The Wendel family was very German in its orientation and origin, being quite self-sufficient, very much endowed with a puritanical philosophy of self-sufficiency and thrift and savings. They never borrowed and always lived within their means. My father had a broad circle of friends there at the university where he covered the health service and also was receiving physicians at Cincinnati General Hospital in the mid-30s, and these are some of his circle of college professorial types that they bummed around with in those days. If you were on my mind all night and day, blame it on my you. If I fall. This is my brother and sister together in the snow. It always seemed like it snowed more in those days than it did in more recent years. Although I must say that in the mid to late 70s, we had some horrendous snowfalls. As you can see, we weren't very skilled at skiing, and these are very old skis that had very primitive bindings. And this was over there on the hills there at Macatewal Country Club that bordered our property. Here I am as a child in the family high chair. I guess I would be just about 1 year old. This would be 1937. My name is Richard George Wendel. And I didn't have an introductory picture on myself. As a kid, our pleasures were a bit simpler than they are today. We did not have any computers or computer games or Game Boys, nor did we have any television. My thumb was always one of my favorite objects, and I sucked it rather incessantly until I think it was almost 6 years of age. This is my mother, Florence. And that's our cat, Blackie, which was really a very prized cat. That cat could handle any dog in the neighborhood. I remember chasing after some very large dogs. My father used to smoke a pipe in his early days, and he graduated to cigars. Very distinguished appearing gentleman.
all night and day.
This was the dining room table around which we studied and did most of academic type stuff, as well as eat, since in those days you really didn't have family rooms, the houses, or libraries for that matter, if you were in the middle of class. Now in the background is Grandpa Wendel. You'll notice every shot I have of him, he's wearing a hat, and indeed in those days everybody wore hats. This is he. I really didn't know him too well until the latter part of his life, at which he wasn't a very lively type guy. He didn't, of course, have that grocery store, and my father as a child worked in the grocery store down on McMicken Avenue close to Walnut Street. Here's Ruthie with some of her friends. The goose step was rather fashionable in those days, preceding World War II. And as we look back, the goose step was very much tied to the Nazis and not very much in vogue today. Those early days, we had a number of different cars. Most all of them were Buicks and four-door sedans, with one set of doors that opened in the reverse way from which they do today. This is a good picture of my mother in front of the house. And my father, Arthur. We still have this sign hanging out at our farm in Claremont County. The three of us kids together. All of us took piano lessons, but none of us became too proficient, although my sister did get up to the level where she could play Claire de Lune. But in later years, she kind of gave this up, even though they did have an organ in their home later on. Shot with my mother and Arthur and Ruth together. Father puts some signage to this. He was a very enthusiastic photographer, and there wasn't a flower in the Crone Conservatory that he didn't at some time or other take a picture of, and most of that footage I have actually cut out. Interestingly, Crone Conservatory today in 2005 is almost identical to what it was in 1936 and 1937. The same waterfall, the same little tunnel behind it, which fascinates kids, and of course the humidity and the Christmas shows, and the poinsettias and so on. Pretty pretty good snowball fight here, and I'd say a pretty good snow castle. This is Art with lacking his two front teeth. And of course, my sister Ruth.
Best piece of symphonic music in the world. Everybody knows this opening, even people who have never been in a concert hall or seen an orchestra play.
All three of us, all kids together, looking at books. Television really didn't come in until about 1946, 1947, and then it was just generally an 8 to 10 inch screen in black and white with programming only covering about 2 or 3 hours a day.
Conducted in an early recording by Leopold Stokowski, immediately followed by the same notes on the CD you have just opened. My God, how can that be the same piece? Which is the right way of playing the music? What does the music really mean? What did Beethoven have in mind? How will we ever know?
I always like my brother's aviator cap, which was so characteristic in those days.
It would be good to be able to hear exactly the tempo he wrote, however shocking and strange it may seem. Then, if you decide that this or that tempo feels wrong, even after you've listened to it a few times, you might say, well, insofar as we know what he intended, I disagree with Beethoven, rather than I disagree with this or that interpreter.
As is so often the case when you have a motion picture camera, you have a tendency to film the same things repeatedly as well as just the holidays. So my father, just like I later on did a lot of photography around Christmas and vacation trips to Dayton and other special occasions, but not much in between. This is the way the tree was laid out at Christmas time. And you can see the assortment of toys, although quite abundant, and indeed in these years while my father was making a good living, nevertheless they were somewhat simple by today's standards, with no battery-powered or remotely controlled type toys.
I believe that they came to see the idea of fate taking on an ever more portentous meaning. Here is Furtwängler, the ultimate German romantic conductor, in a 1953 performance, grand, noble, and full of momentous significance. Took that fateful rhythm, which is also the Morse code sign for V for victory, as the signal for the triumph of the Allied forces.
This is London. In a moment.
This is Aunt Lizzie. That was right my grandfather Wendell's sister, who is a spinster.
His speech lady will be heard all over the empire.
He used to take care of his kids from time to time. There I am sitting in a chair, and my teddy bear is there, and that was one of my favorite toys, which I kept, and the grandchildren even today still play with it. Had a lot of ear infections as a kid, and was frequently picking my ear.
And a metronome mark.
And matter of fact, due to otitis media, I had both my eardrums punctured when I was a lad. Today, why, antibiotics, a couple doses would take care of that pretty promptly. But in those days, there was no penicillin. Sulfa was just coming into being.
As if for the first time. Well, it's true that Toscanini did point the way, and he certainly played this music with a fierce attention to
this. Is a crew up there at Dayton, Ohio. The whole gang is together in front. I'll point out some of the principals that but they all were related: aunts, uncles, cousins, and so on.
The Seventh Symphony is 11 points slower than, and therefore radically different from.
That's Grandpa and Grandma Mueller. Delightful people. He was very energetic, enterprising, upbeat, enthusiastic, really a role model.
Legendary fidelity to the text was a time.
He was a grocer, a White Villa grocer, in fact, in Dayton.
Does this mean that
and since he was a White Villa grocer, and Grandpa Wendel was a White Villa grocer, and my Uncle George was very active in White Villa and was responsible for bringing my mother and father together. And they got married in 1925. So we have a strong history of family with roots in the grocery business, namely White Villa.
Well, yes and no. There is such a thing as a tempo category. If you are inside a category, you're fine.
My grandpa and Grandma Mueller always had beautiful white hair, and they were very proud of it, and received many compliments about it. There I am with my cousin Charlie on Grandpa Mueller's lap. Cousin Charlie, Charlie Mueller became a radiologist and was a professor, full professor at Ohio State University for many years, and gave examinations for the American Board of Radiology. He's now retired, as am I. We keep in touch from time to time, but we were great friends when we were kids. Used to go to camp together and so on. That's Grandma Mueller.
His performance slightly.
It was a very happy gathering. Everyone was upbeat. And I know I always look forward to our trips up to Dayton, Ohio to visit during the holidays with my grandpa and grandma Mueller. Occasionally I stayed with them when my parents went out of town. This in the background is Marjorie Wendel. That's my Uncle George's only daughter. She married John Barry and had four boys, all of which had done extraordinarily well.
Although Beethoven surely didn't want his interpreters to be pedantic,
first husband actually gave some $50 million to Dartmouth College, where both I and my son attended. That's George Wendel, my Uncle George, and his wife Charlotte, and Marjorie.
Perhaps you will decide that you don't like Beethoven's tempo, and that's fine. But at least you now know what Beethoven's own tempo really sounds like.
Unforgettable, that's what you are.
Some pictures out at the farm. This is a view from behind the farmhouse. At that time, this pool had not been put in the ground. That wasn't until, I think, 1956 or 1957. And these would have been taken about 1952. These are some shots of the creek bed in the back of the farm, wonderful hiking with steep cliffs on either side and multiple cascades and waterfalls.
Has someone.
There's Uncle Al negotiating one of the falls, and as you can see, he still has a hat on, as is customary in those days. I don't think I've seen a hat like that in many years.
And forevermore, that's how you'll stay, that's why, darling, you
This is a view from the top of the hill over the stone so creek valley.
Thinks that I am unforgettable too.
This is a picture of my mother. Was pretty athletic and could get around very well until later in life when she had peripheral vascular disease, which really compromised her mobility. This is a picture of the home in Indian Hill. This also would have been about 1952 or 53, and this is a whole Dayton gang. All my mother's sisters and her brother Carl. This a gray-haired gentleman, looks younger than Uncle, than Grandpa Mueller, and her two sisters Helen, and who was the oldest sister, and other sister Mary, who was actually younger. My mother was second. Second to come along with Helen the oldest, and she's second to oldest in the Mueller clan in Dayton.
In every way, and forevermore.
It's a picture of the home when it was first built there in Indiana.
That's how you'll stay. That's why, darling. It's incredible.
This is a little later time frame, and in this picture, Anne, my wife, is pregnant with Nancy, so this would date it at 1960, quite a bit later. And also at that time, you have Matt and Mark and John were all born, so this would be 1961, another Christmas. Christmas Eve, we all gathered and we actually held Christmas at Christmas Eve. And then the other families would have Christmas on Christmas Day with their in-laws. This is Mark and Matt. Here's Anne, is very much in a family sort of way. This has been 1960, and I had been given a Bell and Howe camera. It was flash floodlights, and I was starting to take 16mm pictures, and for our family, I'll be doing some editing on those at a later date. This is in our apartment, which was over on Paxton Avenue, where we lived for a year and a half before moving to Marymount. My father also liked hats and had some fancy hats with feathers. And this is one that he received at Christmas time. Mark and Matt, and one of the multiple parties my parents threw out at the farm, and they all always tried to make it seem authentic with hay rides, with a hay wagon being pulled by a tractor over to Owensville, where they'd eat dinner at the old Boston house and have an excellent chicken meal. This was really their style, and this was their primary way of entertaining for quite a period of time. At these parties, sometimes they each exchanged some sort of a farm-type item. That happened to be a chicken. Here we are launching our major boat on one of the three farm ponds we had out at the farm this week, affectionately called the Frog. This particular lake, which was across from the farmhouse, was a very good fishing lake, and my mother and father developed excellent skills at pulling in largemouth bass and some bluegills. It was about an acre and a half and really quite nice. Now we digress earlier to an earlier time, back to probably about 1959. films are somewhat out of chronological order. Art, my father, was born in 1900, and he passed away at age 88 in 1988 due to just basically old age. He and my mother enjoyed a 50th year anniversary. My mother was born in 1902 and passed away in 1978. After that, my father, when he was 83 years old, remarried a very delightful lady, Mary Seibert, and they had five or six good years together before his passing. This is Art with his convertible and going for golfing, which was his favorite pastime and really a lifelong pastime for him. This is Ruth and Don with their two youngsters. This would be about 1958. This is before Ann and I, shown here, were married. These are the first two grandchildren. You can see Ruth is a very attractive, pretty woman. She also is very gracious and outgoing and a very good hostess. Fur coats in those days are very much in, and to get a fur coat at Christmas time seemed to out of Art and Helen to see if he can resist kissing her. Nope. But she did. A group picture in front of the mantelpiece. They had many a good fire in that fireplace. Copies for the other members of the family if they wish.